जय श्री माता जी। उपस्थित सहयोगी भाई बहनों का हार्दिक स्वागत है। सामूहिक बंधन लेंगे। तीन महामंत्र और श्री गणेश मंत्र। श्री माता जी, कृपावंत होकर हमारे आत्म साक्षात्कार को दृढ़ कर दीजिए। कुछ क्षण परम चैतन्य का अनुभव लेते हैं। हम अब श्री माता जी की अमृतवाणी ग्रहण करते हैं।
I am spellbound to see all this beautiful expression of your love. Such attention and creativity. I must be the luckiest guru. To get the outside nature reproduced here so beautifully. After seeing this, no guru can escape complete melting of his heart. Actually, my disciples are very clever people. They can neutralize any guru. So that Guru's staff, which is used for disciplining the disciple, also melts away into a lotus. Every time it's such a beautiful surprise to see how Sahaja Yogis are getting one with the Divine. The expression of their joy. The conception of the Divine. You can see very clearly, this is how I want you all to sit in the Kingdom of God as I am sitting today. We have to realize that we are now the part and parcel of that cosmic consciousness itself, the Brahma, the one that creates, which coordinates, which plans into all the details, and the one that loves through its creation, through its expression, is that cosmic consciousness. We are not only in it, but we can handle it. We can regulate it. We can use it. We can work it out. This is the state when we are in. We are the Guru. Guru means a thing which is higher than the gravity of the earth, or stronger than the gravity of the earth. What is the gravity of the earth? Superficially, when we see that, we understand it as a thing that acts on our body to keep us on the ground. Also, there is a load of a big atmosphere on our head, of many elephants standing on our head. Plus, the Mother Earth has the gravity to pull us towards herself. That's on the gross level, we understand the gravity. And on the gross level also, we sometimes understand the Guru principle. On the gross level, we think a good Guru is that person who just attracts you towards himself. Bodily attraction. Or maybe other attractions. Which are gross. And that's why people always go to the gurus who are false, who are superficial. But the one who is above the gravity of the Mother Earth, the gross, the subtle, subtler and the subtlest. Beyond all these attractions, that is the one, is the Guru. So, in the very gross way we see that normally people are attracted towards other through the body element. The gravity acting through the body. A guru who looks like a cinema actor was very much appreciated. They cannot see the totality of beauty, but just one aspect. The earlier gurus who came as false gurus used to paint their faces even in India. Or they would go to special decorators who would make their hair look like Shankara's jatas and eyes were painted with big black coal up to this and the whole body was covered with funny type of a powder. Or they would wear a kashaya, a cloth that was given a color of saffron without using the saffron. In 2 rupees you can get that. And people would be attracted towards such a person. They would carry an elephant. To sit on an elephant, even to add to the propensity of the superficial gravity. and walk on the streets. And people would bow to them and give them whatever they wanted. This cannot elevate anyone. Any body attraction can enslave you, cannot give you freedom. It will give you habits for your body enslavements and also it will enslave you to your guru. If he knows how to keep attractive in various ways. The whole understanding of the cosmic consciousness can be put in one little sentence that it cannot be attracted by the gravity of any stars, earth, moon or sun. The other attractions one has from the Mother Earth are all for food, greed, lust, materialism at its worst. It comes from matter. All that comes from matter. Once you start getting used to it, you become a slave and not a guru. So the first attempt should be for anybody to be a good guru is to get over material attraction. In a subtler way, we can see it happens like this. A lady or a gentleman buys an ashram in Sahajyoga. And the Sahajyogis start living in that ashram. The owner of that house starts worrying about the house and all material things in that house rather than the emancipation of the disciples or the Sahajyogis who are there. The whole attention is towards the material upkeep of the house and not towards the emancipation of the Sahajyogis who are supposed to rise into the cosmic consciousness. And such a person, if he starts believing that he is the guru, or in any way, even a Sahajyogi, he is sadly mistaken. Where is your attention is the point. If you are the guru, where is your attention? If your attention is on the correction and the nourishment of yourself and of others, then you are first of all the Sahajyogi. And once you rise, above the gravitational force of materialism, then you could be called as the Guru. Anything that is living has a capacity to rise against the gravity up to a point. That is limited. Like we have seen the trees, they come out of the Mother Earth and grow upward, up to a limited space. Every tree, every type of tree has its own limitations. Cedar will be cedar, and rose will be a rose. Is all controlled by the gravitational force. But there is one thing which rises against the gravitational force, which has no limits, and that is your Kundalini. It cannot be controlled by the gravitational force unless and until you want it to be controlled. Nothing can control it but you and yourself can control it. So as soon as you become in charge of your Kundalini, you have crossed one step forward, that you have overcome the force that is the gravitational force. Then the cycle of all the five elements is bound together. All the five elements have to go in a cycle in such a way that nothing is wasted, nothing is spoiled, everything is organized. But this cycle is broken only by the awakening of the Kundalini. Because you enter into the highest of highest, which is the cosmic consciousness, which you know how to regulate yourself. That cosmic consciousness is the Param Tattva, is the principle of all the principles, controls all the principles. So it controls also the principles of all these five elements. It controls the Manashakti. It controls the evolution and gives you the power to evolve others. So this great Brahma Shakti is at your lotus feet. Perhaps Sahaja Yogis do not realize what they have achieved. The only difference between an Adi Guru and a Guru, Sadguru I would say, is this, that the Adi Guru knows that he is the controlling power. He knows he is with absolute oneness with the Brahma Tattva, with the cosmic. the authority with which he talks, the complete confidence with which he says things. There's no doubt in his mind in any one of his teachings. He'll say, I verily say to you that confidence that I am with the Brahma Tattva, that I am the Brahma, and that I am controlling all that Tattva. Makes him a prophet. Because whatever he says, prophesizes, is the truth. Whatever he says about the past is the truth. And he knows that. He has no doubts. The authority with which Moses talked, authority with which Socrates talked, authority with which Lao Tse talked, all these great Adigurus from Adinath to Sainath, they didn't say, if you do this way will be good or that way would be good. No, this is what it is, you better do it. This is what it is. But in modern times, those gurus may not work out. That's why a mother had to come. First to give you realization. Because these gurus did not realize another point, that their disciples not understand them at all. Whatever they are doing out of awe. But awe doesn't have understanding in it. Or even the earlier ones may have had. The generation that came afterwards did not have. So they turned the gurus into a facade, and the whole building they owned as their own, creating all kinds of problems, killing the universality and the collectivity, because Brahma Tattva is the power of the collectivity, is in everything. In the atom, in the molecule, in the human heart, everywhere it is reflected, depending on the reflector. And it controls this understanding they had. But the human understanding, perhaps they did not have, that if we today tell them something, they might listen to us, but tomorrow they will forget. So it was necessary that you all should be given realization. Otherwise, also without realization, what's the use? What's the use of talking to people about the colors, those who don't have eyes? So realization has to be given. But it should not be done with diffidence. When a guru does not feel vibrations properly, he becomes diffident about giving realization. But even when he feels it clearly, he will not say things with authority. Authority by any chance does not mean aggressiveness. Authority is because you have it, that's why you express it. Like this light is now shining on my face. It is shining, it's not aggressive. Because that's the quality it has got, that it has to shine, so it is shining. In the same way, a guru shines before the disciples. It's very easy to understand this word, shine. When you have something dirty, it doesn't shine. Even the gold, which is always shining, is not tarnishable. If you put it under the mud, it won't shine. So you have to wash it, clean it, and rub it nicely so that it shines. But in Guru Tattva, it is from the basics you have to start. Before the gold came into its own state of gold, it was mixed with so many other things. So it had to be heated up, melted away, sieved out, and so many processes it had to go through to become gold. So when you become Sahajogis, you have become gold. Now the second job is to keep this gold shining. And third would be to get a part in the crown of your mother so that you can never be tarnished. Into these three stages one has to go. First of all, to judge yourself, to be a guru, you have to have a gravity of your own, which is not bound by the gravity of the Mother Earth. That's the minimum of minimum. Which does not mean you wear outside the kashaya, the dress that suggests that you are a sannyas. But from inside, you should be a sannyas. Now a sannyasi who is inside a sannyasi will have a big bank balance maybe, but will know nothing about it. Will be very indifferent and any day willing to part with it. A sannyasi has to be a person above lust. Should not know what is a lust is. What is this attraction of lust is? That थ्रू हिज कुंडलिनी एंड मूलाधारा ही कैन अचीव इट बिकॉज नाउ यू हैव अ कैपेसिटी टू राइज अबव द ग्रेविटी. You have got that power now to rise about this lust business. Where your attention gets absolutely ruined. But in Sahaja Yoga we have everything. Like on Indian streets you will find the most modern car, Rolls Royce, Mercedes, as well as you can find a bullock cart and also lots of cows and buffaloes, everything there. In the same way, I think in Sahaja Yoga we have all kinds. We have some people who are very great. And try to achieve a state of untarnishability. Put their attention to it, work it out. But we also have people who are absolutely useless things, just hanging on to Sahaja Yoga, to use Sahaja Yoga for their own popularity maybe, for their own gains, I don't know for what. I have seen people who give lectures in the name of Sahaja Yoga and are badly caught up. There is that gravity acting in you, remember that. The gravity of the Mother Earth. Some sort of a gravity which should be located. But some of them are nothing but worms. They cannot go higher. And the outsiders see those worms only and try to say that Sahaja Yoga is no good. Your Kundalini has the power. It has all the powers to make you the highest of highest. An ordinary grass can become a cedar. There's no limits to it. But you must have confidence in yourself and confidence in Sahaja Yoga. If you don't have confidence in yourself or in Sahaja Yoga, nothing can work it out. But the highest of all is the sincerity which nobody can instill in you. There are so many descriptions of a guru, how a sadguru should be. Not in the West, I didn't see that, because I think they never believed in gurus, but they have lots of gurus. Like Pope is another horrible fake guru sitting here. Then we have another one, Bishop of Canterbury, sitting there. All of them are false gurus, know nothing about Kundalini, don't know anything Brahma. And they just want to denounce Indian ideas, not because they are Indian, but because if Sahaja Yoga is established, they will lose all their earnings. From where will they get their money and their crowns? So they want to propound that they are the solution, achieving nothing, spoiling the name of Christ, saying all kinds of things against him, stupidly, without knowing the divine. Then we have many in the Islam, horrible people, just the opposite of Muhammad sahab, doing all wrong things in the name of Muhammad sahab. It's something like, one can understand that a thief has to become an imposter, to behave like a king to show that he is not a thief and to have his thieving done. This is how they are, all of them. Right from India, we have many Brahmins of the same category. This priesthood has to go. Wherever there is a priest, no, it's a mafia. It's a sophisticated mafia. No Sahaj Yogi Guru is going to take any money, nor anybody is going to bow to them, nor they are going to take any kind of special attention. In the sense, in one place, we had an ashram where the guru and the guruvi became very important, and the guruvi wanted her tea to be sent on her bed with a proper table, and she became a mini Mataji or a greater Mataji, because I don't demand many things which she demanded. I never demand anything. Whatever you do is very great for me. And this is how they felt they were great gurus, by asking for this privilege and that privilege. Guru has to suffer the most. That's how he can command. He has to be the example of austerity and of detachment. That's how he is going to get respect. In Sahaj Yoga, nobody is going to respect anybody because that guru has made so much money out of Sahaj Yogis. But the attention on money itself of Sahaj Yogis itself is suggestive that they are not Sahaj Yogis. For example, when you wanted to collect money, I never asked for a house or anything. The idea came from some Sahaj Yogis, there should be a house for me. Who can house me? Just think of it. Is it possible? Is it possible to house me? Not possible. So with the purpose and with my name, we could have something done in the heart of the universe, where everybody is sleeping practically. We had to do something dynamic there. And I heard that some stupid people started arguing on that. That's again the sign of not understanding. If mother has said yes, she would not do it for no reason. So the power of understanding only comes when we become the power of cosmic consciousness. Because cosmic consciousness understands each and everything. Sitting down here, you can understand everything, you don't have to go there. Everything. And because your mother is a Mahamaya, it may not show, but it will expose one day. So you have to depend on that part of Sahaja Yoga that it is a Mahamaya's job. So we should not get disturbed or upset. It will show. So you are doubly blessed. First of all, you got your realization, which they say is the hardest of hardest thing to get. You have overcome the gravity. And secondly, your mother is the mother of all the Adi Gurus. She is the one who taught all the Adi Gurus. She created the Adi Gurus, and she'll create out of you the Adi Gurus. But the quality has to be of gold. The Guru has to himself accept all the challenges, everything, to go through it, to work it out, to cleanse himself, to see for himself how far he has reached. He has not just to depend on some certificates of few people. It's not artificiality. It is not falsehood. It is reality. And when you come to reality, you must know that you have to be satisfied about yourself. Then comes the confidence. That's how the authority comes in, that you are sure of yourself, that whatever you are doing is the reality. Reality and nothing else. And this power is within you. The Kundalini is within you, she is your own mother. All your life you have wasted in doing all kinds of things. People have gone into lots of penances, doing anti-culture great jobs of ruining themselves and destroying themselves. What did they get? Then they started another sort. They are busy now with another trip, and they'll be busy tomorrow with another trip. But whatever they do stupid, they do it so seriously. That's the most surprising thing is, into all the details, you know. Nothing should be missing. The complete stupidity must be achieved with full sincerity. That surprises me the most. And then what confidence? If you ask me, why did you do it? He said, what's wrong? You are amazed. There should be a new word rather than bumptiousness for this kind of thing. That you cut your nose, and when the doctor asks you, why did you cut it, is what's wrong? I've done it well, better than you could do. This is how human nature is. That's stupid. But when it comes to reality, how are you? Devastatingly, we work out our destruction. Our construction and our ascent. Do we do it that assiduously, with that caution, with that care, with that detailed understanding? And the best part of it, that when you are doing it, you get joys, immediately rewarded. For example, doing all this, you must have all enjoyed, no doubt. Anything that you do in the name of God is immediately rewarded. The subtlest of subtle in the form of joy, and grossest of grossest in the form of all kinds of things. So why not do it something with complete understanding, meticulously, carefully? Why not? With full attention and concentration. Because the reward is joy. Ultimately, what do we seek is nothing but joy. Rationally we understand, but not from the heart. It doesn't go in the heart easily. Now people are saying, Mother, open my heart. How am I to open it? Just tell me. One has to go for an open heart surgery, I think, the way things are. To open your heart, the Guru has to be generous. Whatever these other agurus are doing, just the opposite of that. What have you given? For example, you are having some people with you in your house, and you are the Guru. What have you given to them? On material level, let us see. Then on physical level, have you ever massaged their head? I have massaged so many people's head. At least 50% of you had that. What physical comfort you have given to that person? If you are the Guru, then what is the emotional confidence you have given to that person? If you are shouting for that person, why did you keep it there? Why didn't you keep it here? Also it is vice versa among human beings. If you try to be nice to somebody, that person becomes ego-oriented. Dangerous stuff, you know. You are nice to somebody, you are kind to that person, you give him some money or you give him something, then they say ego comes in that person. I'm surprised sometimes, how can it be? But it happens. I mean, I have been victim of such a nonsense. That people had to say, Mother, you have spoiled that person. I just don't know, how can I spoil? Why it happens? Because human beings have another great quality, that they cannot understand that anybody can care for them, because they cannot care for anyone. Anybody cares for them, they become egoistical.
अब हम थोड़ी देर इसी स्थिति में ध्यान करते हैं। श्री माता जी की पावन प्रतिमा को देखते हैं, नमन करते हैं, हृदय से आभार व्यक्त करेंगे और प्रार्थनाएं अर्पित करेंगे। परम पूज्य श्री माता जी, आज का सामूहिक ध्यान हम आपके श्री चरणों में समर्पित करते हैं। आज के ध्यान में आपने हमें जो निरानंद प्रदान किया, चैतन्य से आशीर्वादित कर दिया, इसलिए हम आपके हृदय से ऋणी हैं माँ। संपूर्ण विश्व में विश्व निर्मल धर्म प्रस्थापित करने हेतु कृपा कर हमें सहयोग प्रचार प्रसार का शुद्ध एवं प्रभावी माध्यम बनाइएगा। हमारी सभी प्रार्थनाओं का स्वीकार कर हमें आशीर्वादित करने की कृपा कीजिए श्री माता जी। अब हम सामूहिक बंधन लेते हैं। आज का ध्यान यही संपन्न होता है। जय श्री माता जी।